watching NRATV with Bill Whittle.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Hot Mike Show from Los Angeles. I'm Bill Whittle, sitting in for Hot Mike, who is apparently still at the breakfast restaurant. Somebody wouldn't let go of his ego, and it got really ugly, so we hope to have him back by tomorrow. Today, I want to talk about Generation Snowflake. It's a term that's been used quite a lot lately, and it's a result of what I suspect really was a well-intentioned idea. But as we say in the modern world, no good deed goes unpunished. So here's the theory. These young people today who are in college and just entering the job market, and speaking in broad generalizations now, have really got some emotional problems. And one of the reasons they've got so many emotional problems is a result of the self-esteem movement, which was one of those ideas that progressives just really love to grab onto because it gives them a chance to control something. And basically, what the self-esteem movement taught was that if you do nothing but flatter children and tell them how awesome they are, then that will give them self-esteem and they'll be able to go out into the world and succeed. But that's not what self-esteem is about. That's not how self-esteem is created. In real self-esteem, you go out into the world and you fail and succeed, and then you start to have a feeling of pride in what you do. Because these people have never been allowed to fail. This generation snowflake, we call them snowflakes because every single one of them, this is what they're told all day growing up, every single one of them is so precious and unique and delicate, and they melt the second anybody touches them. So that's where the term came from. To give you an idea of the kind of language and the kind of buffering, that's a better word, the kind of emotional buffering that institutions in this country are bending over backwards to continue to provide to these grown adult infants. Let's take a quick look at a clip from the late lamented Last Man Standing show with Tim Allen.
Do you want me to give you some notes before you send it in?
Why, send it in? What do you mean?
The faculty committee needs to approve it after they check for microaggressions.
Microaggressions? You mean like midget warriors?
No, they're objectionable words or phrases. For instance, midget warriors.
I know what microaggressions are. It's the latest liberal attack at free speech. And a lot of fun if you do them right.
The university has a list of stuff they don't allow speakers to say, you know, to protect the students.
From what, ideas?
It's just the way that my school does things, Dad. Please, my grade is riding on this.
Fine. All right. Just pretend like you introduced me to thunderous applause. Sure. Some lady faints in the front row. Ladies and gentlemen.
Okay, stop.
No, they'll pick her up. Come on, EMS, get her out of here.
You can't say ladies and gentlemen because it excludes those who don't identify as either.
But those are the only two choices.
No, not anymore. You just have to keep it gender neutral, okay? Please continue.
Hey, everybody! America's the land of opportunity. I stand before you
as... Stop. Okay, by saying that America's the land of opportunity, you are implying that everyone has the same opportunities.
I'm not implying it, I'm saying it. If you live here and you work hard, you can succeed. That's how this works.
Yeah, that one's on here too. It hurts the feelings of those who work hard and don't succeed.
Where's the list of stuff that doesn't hurt people's feelings? That's gotta be a short one.
Yeah. He's exactly right. Where's the list of things that doesn't hurt people's feelings? That ought to be a short one. We are entering in a world now where people are competing to be offended. That's really what it comes down to. There's a competition going on to show how virtuous you are, and the way you can show how virtuous you are today is by showing how offended you are. We're about to bring in a very, really terrific guest, but let me just tell you one last thing about this generation that we're talking about, the snowflake generation. And again, I'm speaking in terms of broad generalizations, but some of you may not realize this. This is some things we can say about the millennials generally. They've never been hungry. They've never been cold. They've never been without entertainment. They've never had to live with pain or except very briefly on the way to the hospital. They've always had their needs pretty much instantly gratified, Every picture they ever drew went on the refrigerator, and they got all the gold stars because every single one of them is a great artist. They never kept score in anything they did. There were no winners, and that meant no losers. See how it works? If there's no losers, then they won't have any self-esteem issues. So that's something that they've had to deal with. Because they didn't keep score, they've never had a chance to fail at little things. They never failed at a soccer game, never lost a soccer game or a Little League baseball game, so they don't know what failure is. They don't know anything other than just constant pats on the back. Many of them have had to struggle for attention in a daycare center. If you think about it, growing up in a big family, I'm one of four, I'm the eldest of four, there's a little struggle for attention. But when there's 30 kids there, sometimes the only way you can get attention is to act out emotionally. And I think that's something we'll be talking about in a minute. They're not allowed to compete with each other except, as I said, in terms of victimhood. Then they're encouraged to compete. They've been taught to share everything. They've been taught that boys are essentially defective girls and they shouldn't stop looking out the window and all the rest of the stuff. And finally, they've been taught to work as a group. They have no initiative. They have been treated like infants their entire lives, and it's not their fault. They didn't ask for this kind of treatment. It's our fault. But that's what we have. We have adult infants now who can't drive. They have nervous breakdowns if they're confronted with doing the laundry. And most importantly, they've never been confronted with any other ideas other than the fact that they are the most brilliant, wonderful thing in the entire universe. And when they run into something counter than that, they really start to act out. And we're seeing this on campuses all across the country, apparently with one or two exceptions. Our guest today is Dr. Everett Piper. He's the president of Oklahoma Wesleyan University, and he wrote a book called Not a Daycare, The Devastating Consequences of Abandoning Truth. Dr. Piper is dealing with these issues on a daily basis. And Dr. Piper, thanks so much for being with us today.
Oh, I'm honored to join you. Thank you.
I've maintained that these are essentially adult children. They're infants. They're 4 or 5 year old kids who have been basically stunted and are now entering college and the workforce. Do you think that's a fair assessment?
I do. What we have today is we have the result of teaching some of the terrible ideas that you described in your lead-in. If you harken back to Richard Weaver's work in 1948, he warned of this. He wrote a seminal work titled Ideas Have Consequences, and what was his point? Ideas have consequences. Ideas matter. They always bear fruit. There's no such thing as a neutral idea, value neutrality or moral neutrality. All ideas are either going to bear good fruit or bad fruit. And when you teach selfishness, self-absorption, narcissism, self-actualization, you're going to have selfish kids, self-absorbed behavior, and you're going to have narcissists in the public square screaming and calling out for them to be patted on the head and be given a participation trophy rather than pursuing what's right and just and real and true in the academy, which is why the liberal arts institution was established in the first place.
Yeah, I remember when you would go to a college in order to get new viewpoints. Now the purpose of a university is to protect you from getting any new viewpoints. Dr. Piper, I want to just play a quick little clip here. It's rather a famous clip, has about 3 million views. It's a young woman, a college student, reacting to a Milo Yiannopoulos speech. And the thing I'm most interested in here is the emotional state on her face, and just to watch how quickly this changes. Let's roll that clip.
Future generations will look back.
One more disruption, and we have to ask you to leave the venue.
My free speech!
No, you're not. You have to obey the rules of the venue.
But this is free speech if you're so concerned.
Not free speech.
Yes, it is.
Please keep your comments. Please keep your comments to the Q&A session.
Please keep your hate speech out of this campus.
Keep your hate speech.
So, Dr. Piper, that clip, as I say, has got about 3 million views, and it's kind of held up as the example of this social justice warrior infantilism. But the thing that's remarkable about that clip to me, and I was curious to know if you've been seeing this yourself, is that this person is essentially angry, but they're relatively calm. They're sipping a drink or something, and then somebody starts to chant. And the second that they start to chant, her emotional state goes absolutely nuclear, just absolutely nuclear. And then the second the chant stops, she sits right back down again and goes back to her drink. This is emotion that is being orchestrated, isn't it? That's the word I'm looking for.
Education today is grounded more in feelings than facts, and this is exactly what you just saw. This person thinks that an education should be grounded in her feelings, in her opinions. And at Oklahoma Wesleyan University, I don't give you degrees and opinions. I don't pat you on the back when you graduate and say, congratulations, you majored in opinions. And in fact, when you graduate from my university, I don't care what your opinion is, and I really don't think you should care that much about mine. A good education, a classically liberal education, an education that liberates us and sets us free. That's why it was established in the first place 1,000 years ago at Oxford, to educate a free man and a free woman, a free culture and a free society. Thus the word liberal, liberty, liberation, freedom. That education is grounded in pursuing what's true, those self-evident truths that are endowed to us by our Creator, not in celebrating your feelings and pandering to your opinions. Pol Pot and Mao and Robespierre and Chavez and Hitler and Mussolini, all the despots of history had opinions and it didn't end well. But Jesus told us, you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free.
Yeah, that's very well said. I remember the ideal of a kind of education that you're talking about, which is not so much stuffing your head with information so much as teaching you how to think. I know by far the greatest class I ever had was debate, because in debate you have to weigh evidence, you have to analyze various experiments and so on. But it's so fascinating to me, because I remember thinking, and I remember being told, that the ultimate kind of an education you could get would be when you could defend a position that you personally found reprehensible. If you understood it well enough to defend a position that was completely opposite to what you took, you were considered an educated person. But these people are, they've been absolutely determined to not hear anything other than what they want to hear.
Well, as a matter of fact, for example, Milo. I'm not a fan of Milo. I disagree with Milo on a lot of things. But ironically enough, Milo would probably have more freedom to debate here at Oklahoma Wesleyan University, a conservative Christian institution, than he would in the secular academy today, because at Oklahoma Wesleyan, in our tradition, in our classically liberal arts tradition that's grounded in a biblical worldview, we believe that truth should judge the debate, not Milo, not me, not power, not privilege, not the pundit, not the pulpit, not the pastor, not the priest, not the professor. We actually believe that there's a referee on the game, and that referee would be the self-evident truths that are endowed to us by our Creator. Objectivity rather than subjectivity.
Well, we know objectively, we know for a certain fact that he'd get better treatment at Oklahoma Wesleyan University than he would at Liberal College, because Berkeley's banned him from speaking. They've simply banned him from speaking. They don't want to have a discussion because everything that they do is based on their emotions. They don't know how to defend their positions. They don't even know what their positions are. I had to go to a college once, it was Oberlin, and I had to explain to them what socialism was so that they could, have some kind of rational basis for why they were wrong. What are some of the most outrageous examples that you've heard about, Dr. Piper?
Well, Berkeley, let's start with Berkeley. Berkeley fancies itself as the birthplace of the free speech movement. Well, I would argue it clearly isn't, because freedom of speech has been lost. Ideological fascism is prevailing rather than academic freedom. This is not free speech. I would argue that Bethlehem is really the birthplace of the free speech movement, much more so than Berkeley, because it's Christ that told us, you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free, rather than these protests and this pandering that's taking place at places like Berkeley. You have the University of Wyoming, and then even the University, Brown University. These are two examples of institutions that actually have counseling centers today, where they provide their students with Play-Doh, bubbles, coloring books, and videos of frolicking puppies during those times that students might feel anxiety, for example, during finals week.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And ladies and gentlemen, it took us a while, but we found an actual educator here. We actually found somebody who understands what an education is. And when we come back right after the break, we're going to be talking about some of the most egregious examples of this kind of monster generation that the left has created, and how they have come to fear it themselves. They've come to fear their own creation. We'll be right back on the Hot Mic Show. I'm Bill Whittle here on NRATV.